My own interest has been spiralling around manifold archaei, manifold meanings, scattered sparks in the dark, world soul as qualities of whole numbers, and the forms emerging from them, suspended in time with the basket of the tetractus. For now, all I want to do is hint at the enormity of vision and profound work of Jung's Vishnu Brahman cube stone and its awakened five planets and two luminaries. There they are, on the forgotten stone, with Jung's little chiselled mercurial Telesphorus, son of Asclepius. He travels the world with his small lantern, illuminating facets of world, illness, dreams, ecology, creatures, when we truly attend to the despised corner of the psyche, the dream. Naturally, I am once again lauding the daughter of Asclepius, sister of Telesphorus, Hygieia, whose name always adorned the quintessential and spiraling five-pointed star of the Pythagorean Oath of Healing, a promise to attend to all the gods and goddesses for health's sake, Hygieia, matter's heart. She is another image of Mercuria, life force, Satyagraha, and her profound indications of a possibility of humankind's willing alignment with true proportion, balance, and justice throughout and of the earth. It is with this capacity and with this value system and lifestyle that the Adivasi peoples of the heart of India show us how we might love earth and each other, a reclamation of dignity. During deep illness, Jung saw something new emerge from a place he had quickly visited in January 1938, a golden triangle of ancient pilgrimage. This is now exactly a dark triangle of deepest ecological crisis on India's east coast off the Bay of Bengal, a critically polluted cluster industrial area. It is as if from this time and place, shown through a dream in deep illness, that Jung wrote his last diamond works. Decolonizing methodologies of subaltern studies model a hands-on, urgently needed engagement with Jung's earlier 1927 statement that he who is rooted in the soil endures, and that alienation from the unconscious and from its historical conditions spells rootlessness. Sitting together on the forest floor in Orissa, gathering in the villages, literally preserving seeds, scholars like Dip Kapoor, for example, learn with the Adivasi, the original inhabitants, the indigenous people of India, root people, sons and daughters of the soil for 5,000 years, now experiencing genocidal brutalities through state, national, and global corporate forces spiraling calamitously around aluminium and the bauxite plunder of the mountains and lands of the Adivasi of India and Orissa in particular. Their ways, struggles, and materials are around food, land, water, jungle. Unity land, water, forests. One thing, aiming to preserve nature and enhance its influence in their lives and continue their age-long self-sufficiency. They have much to teach. There is much we must learn. In the developing conception of my life, it is astonishing for me to note, September the 13th, 2012, that bauxite was first discovered in 1821 as the aluminium-rich rock at Les Baux, and named as bauxite in the 1840s by the French geologist P. Berthier. It is named after a Baux, an extraordinary rock spur 250 metres high, on which stands a medieval citadel. As a source of aluminium, it was mined out by the end of the 20th century. Bauxite deposits have played an essential role in giving birth to some of the world's most outstanding areas of fertility. The northeast peninsula of Australia, West Africa, the Amazon Basin, Orissa, and Provence in the south of France. To add further to my complete astonishment, Les Baux is a few kilometres northeast of Les Aliscamps, the ancient necropolis in the outskirts of Arles, where I place the beginning of Jung's work of engagement with the realm of the dead and the beginning of his opus, To Speak with the Dead and Those Enduring Human Values Which Require Resuscitating. A few miles further south of the necropolis of Arles is Sainte Marie de la Mer, St. Mary's of the Sea, where archetypal Mary Magdalene, her sister Martha, Mary Salome, Mary Jacobi, Lazarus and others are said to have landed, 29 of the Common Era, after a perilous sea journey. The local story is still very much alive today. I have journeyed to this field four times, participating in the yearly May festival of Sarah Carley, being drawn out of the ancient crypt for her celebratory bathe in the sea. The occasion is richly and passionately imbued with Rom music and dancing, with ritual bull racing through the little town, escorted by the skilled Rom horsemen on their magnificent white Camargue horses. Les Baux, with its aluminium connections, however, is associated with St. Martha and her bunch of keys, a real chatelaine. One key will never do. Every year, through the streets of the medieval town of Les Baux, in this same Aliscamp field, this necropolis field, there is a ritual drama of the Tarascon dragon that in earlier times had continually haunted the area, snatching people into its cavernous, ever-greedy mouth and belly. It was Martha, says the local story, who was known to rescue those who had been thus devoured. It is Martha and her ingenious ways that was and is able to draw forth those who had been swallowed alive, gobbled up by the ravening beast. In the field of the ancient Roman Aliscamp necropolis, the field which I suggest is the archetypal source of Jung's confrontation with the unconscious, Martha and Mary Magdalene are both well known for their healing ministries. And now, my conception narrative seems to have come full circle. Reconceiving, living on the prairies, and during recovery from deep illness, differentiating Mercuria from Mercurius in 2006. Reflecting on and visiting the necropolis of the dead of the ancient Aliscamp, the marshy Eleusinian fields, confronting the unconscious in the field of the Marys and during Worlds at War 2011. Revisioning a bride of earthly substance and authority 2007 and 8, travelling with Constance and Sunbeam into places of renewed self-conceptions, from Orissa in India to Saint-Albert, Amiens, and the Vimy Memorial in northern France, and the ancient necropolis of Provence, with its originating threads to the dragon of the gobbling global aluminium cartel. A dream suggests that I am a tiger in India, tracking Jung, who is also a tiger. The dream makes me laugh. Round and round we go, sniffing and padding, padding and sniffing, sometimes growling, stealthy creatures. Of course, there are differences. I'm a tango dancer. I don't think Jung was. A spiral dream journey is a personal settling into a mandala, into the maternal hearth, forever recreating. Lotus position in the triangles of interwoven gold and deepest darkness, fire and ice. Oh yes, I nearly forgot. Now you know why I have an elephant in my waiting room.